Well, I don't know.
I'm being honest with you. I can't be bothered. And I feel like I'm part of it. I'm part of the problem.
From Germany is like, especially Hamburg, only the taxi drivers drive big cars, like Mercedes, but it's a taxi car though. You get me? So I didn't even see anyone. I remember being fresh in London in East Croydon.
Of all the places.
Of all the places, yeah, East Croydon. I'm just walking down East Croydon, going to a train station, and I see a black guy in a red Ferrari. I remember it as if it was yesterday. I've never in my life till that time saw anyone with our skin color driving such a car. So seeing that, I was like, nah, all right, cool, say less.
Yeah. Going on, man.
Blessings, bro.
Thanks for coming, man.
Come on, man.
Your name has come around, has been around my radar for a while because of mutual friends. The idea for my podcast is basically to speak to black Germans, and have a conversation regarding how black Germans are kind of pushing their narrative within Germany,
okay,
as compared to black British people, right, which you know very, very, very well.
Yeah.
So to start, I think it would be good if you can tell us a little bit about your journey being from Hamburg, Germany, and London, and everything.
So I'm Emmanuel, born and raised in Germany, Hamburg. Born in Hamburg City Ost, that's like the eastern part of Germany, Hamburg. Jenfeld, that's the precise name of where I grew up. Went to school here, did everything here, and then when I somewhat in, so basically I started playing football. So I was a footballer, got injured, the standard story, and then couldn't play football no more. And then I think somewhere 2012, 2013, when I finished school here, I went to Stuttgart, which is in the southern part of Germany, lived there for 2 years. And school wasn't schooling for me here. So it wasn't going
school
well,
wasn't
bro.
Schooling.
School wasn't schooling, bro. So, bro, I was bad, bro. Hmm. I wasn't getting anything done here.
Yeah.
So, funny enough, my pastor was like, bro, just move to London.
Who?
My pastor.
Really?
Yeah, my pastor.
Why him? Of all the people?
Because me and him, we are like brothers. Hmm. So he's like, He's like I think he's like 10 years older than me, so he's like my big brother.
What's his name?
Pastor Randolph.
Okay.
Pastor Randolph. So he was like, you should, like, because I was doing some business economics school studies somewhere in Stuttgart. I was like, you know what, everything around you is music, so just go study music. Then it was like a penny drop, basically. So started applying, went through the whole process of applying for universities in the UK and stuff like that. God being so good, got the admission for it. And then,
Kingston University.
Kingston University, yes.
Oh, got some people there still.
Is it? Yeah, Kingston University was a interesting place. Very interesting. But 2015 is when I moved to London. Mm. And ever since, been London. Lived there, did my whole studies there, worked there, established my own business there. And now I've been in and out since the pandemic hit. I was in and out, Hamburg, London, Hamburg, London, Hamburg, London. But predominantly everything that I would say London made me, bro.
Yeah?
Yeah, 100%.
Yeah. London can do that.
Yeah. London made me like what I am. And who I am right now, and by the grace of what I'm doing, if it wasn't for London, I don't think I would be anywhere close to what I'm
doing. So what are you doing? Let's tell the people.
So I'm a music producer, I'm a songwriter, saxophonist, working on some little business ventures as well. But predominantly music. Touring with a lot of artists at the moment.
Name some names, man. Let the people know. So, man. Name some names.
So I've been touring with Ashake. I've been touring with Davido. at this point. I'm the official saxophonist for him. I've done my own songs as well. If I do music personally, I'd rather go into the gospel side of things. Mm. So, been producing, been co-producing, been writing songs. So I've done songs with celebrities like Dave, Burna Boy, Rema.
Jesus.
J5, who's one of my big brothers in the music thing. Worked with the likes of composers. Like, there was a bunch of people I've worked with. NSG, like... Yeah, the names are just dropping, but yeah. So, yeah, bro, that's what I've been doing.
No, that's an accomplishment for somebody who didn't really do school too tough.
Yeah,
bro, you have to give yourself a pat on the back for that.
Yeah. So that's what I'm doing right now. So as we speak, I'm preparing myself, flying out tomorrow to London to do some studio sessions, and then after that, got on tour the whole December through till end of January, just working and being all over the place.
That's good, man.
Yeah.
So how do you think Germany shaped your life?
Bro, if I'm... I don't know if Germany did, to be fair.
It has to, but it must have done something.
If it did, if Germany shaped my life, I would say Germany shaped my life in a sense where... there's something we call deutsche Tugend stuff, right? Typical things that Germans do, being on time.
I was just about to say
That's something that is just in our nature. Like, we are on time. So we are, me personally, I'm very punctual if I want to, but I'm very punctual, but I can't deal with unpunctuality, especially if it's serious things, right? I feel like that's something, but the rest, I wouldn't know what, to be fair.
Yeah?
I wouldn't know what.
Like, family, church?
No.
No?
Nothing. Wow.
So how did London shape your life then?
I feel like London shaped my life in a sense where the resilience, not taking no for an answer, being sharp, like, and being fast. I feel like London is a fast-paced city. Like, if you're slow there, someone will outsmart you very, very quickly. And however, London also gave me the how will I call it? When I moved to London, that's where I started dreaming.
I see it.
Because now it is not just, what I know from Germany is, like, especially Hamburg, is like only the taxi drivers drive big cars, like Mercedes, but it's a taxi car though. You get me? So I didn't even see anyone. I remember being fresh in London in East Croydon. Bro.
Of all the places,
yeah, East Croydon. Because my uncle, who was a pastor in London, lived in East Croydon, like a mission house in East Croydon. Yeah. So I was there for the start of my stay in London. And I'm just walking down in Shredding, going to a train station, and I see a black guy in a red Ferrari, and he was bold. I remember it as if it was yesterday. And I've never in my life till that time saw anyone with our skin color driving such a car. Never. So that was like, raw. What is it like? So seeing that was like, nah, all right, cool, say less.
Yeah.
I can get that too. I can get there too. So yeah, it's like in London is where you also see black people succeeding and doing great things. And that just gave me basically the boost to be like, all right, cool, I will do great things too. Because in Germany, as at the time I grew up, I never saw that like that. It's just the uncles and aunties doing the regular jobs, cleaning, with no disrespect,
They're making a living.
But you know, that's what we're used to. We didn't see anyone like having his own business or doing this for himself or stuff like that. Of barrier and all of that. But it was in London where I saw people having their own businesses, people doing their own things, people like hustling and making something for themselves. So what London
did. London will do that too.
London will do that.
London is so fast paced. So we've done the opposite. You moved to London, I moved to Hamburg.
Yeah.
And people call me crazy for that because of obvious reasons. Hamburg is slow. People are not as sharp as they are in London. For me, I see a lot of opportunities in Hamburg.
Right.
I see that one, if you start a business and you're on point, being from London, I'm on point.
Mm.
And when I say that, I mean, I know how to market things. I know how to make things look good.
Right.
I know how to place a product in a certain position where people can look at it and think, at least think, this is something new.
Yeah.
And if you do something like that, you know that there's probably no competition.
I hear that.
In Germany. Mm. Probably no competition. Mm. The challenge, though, is how to reach Germans, because Germans are different from British people. But again, as a business, it's all about overcoming and figuring out things. Mm. So that's why I see that Germany, there's a lot of opportunities in Germany. I still do have a business in London that I run. Like, I haven't left London completely.
Mm.
So we've done the opposite. So for you, London kind of brought you opportunities.
Yeah.
It opened your eyes to see certain things. And those kind of things that you see in London, like people doing businesses and people like the guy in a Ferrari, these are things that you won't necessarily see here in Germany, apart from a footballer, maybe.
Apart from a footballer. Yeah.
So at this point, what do you think that the state of Black Germans are? Is
in
the state of Black Germans, like in Germany? In Germany. What do you think it is? Where do you think it is at the moment?
I feel like they're picking up.
Yeah.
I feel like they are, but not everyone's picking up. Mm. I see a couple of brothers who are doing well, who are doing their thing, but it is not as, if someone is doing well in London or in the UK, you see it, it's in your face. Like, this guy's doing well. I feel like in Germany, you don't really see it. A lot of people are very DL, very down low, very like low key. But I see one by one people getting into very good positions in good companies. For instance, I have a friend who lives down south, and she's working for Porsche, like has a great position there. So you can see like the ones who are on, basically, they are getting into certain places. I have a cousin who works for a marketing firm that deals with Louis Vuitton and stuff like that. Mm. You know, so you have people that are actually doing stuff. However, it's not the norm. Mm. I would want to see, like, out of 10 Black Germans, I would love to see like 8 doing great. Mm. But for what I know, I don't see it like that. Mm. I see Black Germans doing great stuff, but not getting to the high positions. They're more in the middle ranges. Like, you know, I don't want to name some jobs now because then that would be like maybe attacking someone one or two. But
yeah,
I would just want to see. But I feel like there's progress. Mm. It's better than, because now our generation is getting older, right? Mm. So we are having businesses and we are trying to do one or two things here. But
yeah,
I feel like in terms of doing stuff, London is way advanced.
The last conversation I had, last episode, I was saying, since you're in music, I would want us to kind of touch on this.
So,
I was saying to Martina that for me, where London, Black British people, not just London, Black British people really began to grasp their power and start kind of moving high was because we had our own identity. We had our own music.
Okay.
The music brought us together.
Right.
Nobody was listening to garage music. Nobody was listening to grime music apart from Black people.
Black people,
that was our shit.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
When Giggs would make his music and they'll ban him from certain places, we will still support him and say, nah, that's our guy.
That's our guy, yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And the music brought us together. It gave us a collective kind of feeling.
Okay.
Until recently, Afrobeats, I feel, pushed that.
Pushed it like...
Blew it.
Out of proportion.
Exactly. Yeah. I think you can see this.
Yeah,
because 100%. When you see people like Burner Boy and Wizkid selling out O2 as a, and this, I'm not, usually when people come to O2 and they sell it out, the rappers and stuff from the USA,
yeah,
it's filled with white people, black, but when Wizkid and Burner Boy come to O2 and they sell it out, predominantly black, it's black people.
100%.
So we've begun to see that, you know what, if we come together and we can do this, yeah, like we can do anything. Mm-hmm. So for me, just before the coronavirus and after the coronavirus, there was a shift in black British mentality of supporting one another because of these things, yeah, that has just made us like fly. So we're on our way now. You don't get that in Germany.
You don't.
Germans, black Germans don't even own their own music.
No.
Like, I listen to hip hop music here and it's just white people and Turkish,
yeah,
people.
Yeah.
Why do you think that is?
Whew, that's a tough one. This is a difficult question. You know what? The thing is, I feel like, see how you said, like, in your time when Gix would do his garage or grime or whatever or not, there was like a feeling of, this is ours.
Always.
We don't have that here.
Yeah.
I feel like with us, it is more of like, that one's doing that, so we are looking at it, but like, you know, there's no like, all right, cool, my brother's doing that, let me push that thing, or let me like support it, or let me like be with that person, or like let me I don't know, be like supportive. Yeah. Like I feel like we in Germany, our problem is like there's nothing really uniting us
in music. Should be doing that,
it should be, but we don't even, I don't know one black artist in Germany that is doing massive. There's one rapper that I know, Luciano. I might misquote it. He is mixed race looking. So it could be like he's the black figure, right? So I think he's one of the biggest, or even the biggest rapper right now. But apart from that, as you said, there's just Germans doing the rap. There's the Turkish doing the rap. And even if a black guy is trying to do something, like there was one guy called Emmanuelsen, he was also doing like, he was rapping, but we didn't push it. We didn't feel like as though he was with us.
Why is that?
I don't know. I feel like,
was he rapping in German or in?
He was rapping in German.
Okay.
He was rapping in German, but I feel like he was, the way he grew up, and I might be mistaken as well, but the way we grew up, it more seemed like he was more with the Turkish people, right? So it just felt like maybe his music and the way he would speak, it's more to the Turkish people. I think he would want to appeal to the black as well, but I don't know. Me personally, for instance, I wasn't listening to him like that. Yeah, I wasn't listening to him like that. So it even shows you, like, me, I'm a black person, I'm in Germany, but I don't listen to my fellow black person. To my fellow black brother. So
what do you know why you weren't listening to, you like black German music?
I don't think it appealed to me, bro. I feel like what black Germans would do is they would not look at themselves, but they will look abroad.
Yeah.
So me, for instance, maybe instead of listening to my brother Manuelsen, I would be listening to 50. I'll be listening to R. Kelly and them. You know, like, I'll go America. Like, I didn't even know the UK scene, UK scene existed like that. But it will be the American, like, I'll be there. So my brother who's trying to do Azonto here in Germany, I'm not pushing that because at the end of the day, it doesn't sound, I don't know. I'm not appealed to that. I was more appealed to that. So you know what just came to my mind? Maybe it would be something like, We are not ready to grow with the people here. So we want to see the already finished product, as in like the 50. Yeah, he was already like the big star.
Yeah.
But like that brother that is pushing the music, or that is doing music, push him too. Like give him that support as well. Yeah. And I feel like I'm part of it. I'm part of the problem.
The problem. Yeah. I mean, anytime there's something like this,
I'm reflecting right now.
We're all part of the problem.
Yeah.
The thing is, with the UK, because I got to the UK quite late, like when I was 17. And at that time, when I got to the UK, grime music was quite bubbling. But I was back and forth in the UK, so I knew about garage music and, you know,
yeah,
the Artful Dodger and Craig David and all that, yeah, whole era there. But grime music was coming up, and I didn't really like grime music, but I respected it because it was a bunch of boys from like the estates coming together, doing ciphers, doing DVDs, and even though nobody at the collective outside of that community really listen to them. Yeah. They didn't care.
Yeah.
This is our shit.
Yeah,
they just did it.
Yeah.
And they kept doing it until they got to Dizzy Rascal. And it started getting bigger.
Bigger.
And it started getting to other people. And now is, I think now is more British rap than anything. Yeah. But still now, British rap in Britain is probably more popular than American rap.
True. True.
So it's like we, from the beginning, we grasped it and said, this is ours. If you rapped in American accent back in those days in Britain, nah, people weren't feeling it.
Crazy.
Nobody. Even if you rapped, people weren't feeling it. It was all about grime because that was our thing. If you rapped, they're like, oh, you're copying Americans. You're
copying.
Do you know what I mean? So until you became comfortable, now people can rap freely.
You see, with what you're saying, yeah, there's this notion. There's this notion that says, like, Germany in its own doesn't have its own identity.
It doesn't.
Let's put even us black people aside. Mm. Germany, the country in its own, doesn't have its own identity. And I feel like with what you're saying, if you don't recognize something as your own and you identify yourself with it, you don't see the value of it. And I feel like because there's such a lack of identity with us, with the country itself, maybe it dribbled down onto us black people that are here or that grew up here, and that's why we don't value what is ours. We don't value the people that are doing things, that are pushing things in our community. Like, yeah, it's sad, but because, for instance, what you just said, you said something like, if you rap in an American accent in UK, that's all what we were doing here in here in Germany.
A few people tried in the UK, it didn't work.
That's all we were doing here. I remember me back then when I was 14, 15, I would have a durag on and I would put my hat like this because that's what the Americans are doing. And that's what I like. Yeah. But there was nothing like an own culture thing in Germany where we'd be like, all right, cool. The UK, they have grime. Mm. The Americans, they do their hip hop stuff. What do we have?
Even Nigeria and Ghana have Afrobeats now, so...
So what do we have?
I think that, for me, is the core of Germany, black Germans' problems. I think that's the core of it. Because until you can have something and be proud of it, and collectively be proud of it, I don't think you can kind of come together as a people.
This conversation is blowing my mind because I'm like, rah. Because I'm thinking, like, what actually do we have as black people in Germany to say, like, this is... hours.
It's the hip hop part that blows my mind. There's an even like just R&B and Afro soul music. I there was a lady that I listened to. I heard she lives in Hamburg by the name of Yakoto. I used to listen to her when I was in London.
Mm.
Amazing musician. I loved her music. I listen to her music all the time.
Mm.
And I come to Germany and I don't hear her music anywhere.
I don't even know who you're talking about. What's her name?
Yakoto. She's a Ghanaian girl. She's mixed race. Yeah.
I have no idea who she is.
Brilliant music.
And she's from here?
She's from Germany. I heard she lives in Hamburg.
No way.
Yeah. I heard. I'm not sure if it's true, but yeah. I heard. So it's like things like that makes me think that black Germans are almost there, but until they can have some sort of identity where they're proud of, it's going to be a bit of a struggle.
Yeah, it will. Because I'm actually, as we were talking, I'm thinking, I'm like, what can I say, like, this is German and I'm proud of it, that I was part of it or something. But everything that I can think of now is something that was imported from somewhere else.
Yeah.
Because I remember back then there was like a season where we'd teach me how to jerk. Like there was a dance season and stuff where we're jerking and stuff like that. But that's also from abroad. That's from America. That's not like, it's not us. Yeah. There's no movement, whether it's music, whether it's art in any way, where we were like, this thing came from Germany.
Yeah. So if you look at two examples I'll give you, like UK back in about maybe 2006 or so, whatever it is, 2006, 2007, if you went to the club, they'll play the American music, they'll play the hip hop. Apart from some songs like Ludacris, yeah. Move Bitch, which gets people hype. They'll play that, and they'll play the other Fat Joe, What's Love, and all of those things. It'll be cool in the club. But when they throw on the grime, bro, the club goes off. Because this is our bit. This is what we do. Even at my wedding, the DJ was from UK. So when he threw on the grime, we the boys from UK, we went crazy. Off. Everybody was just looking at us like, what are they doing? Like, you have no idea.
No
like,
way.
This is our thing. Mm. Do you know what I mean? So that's one example. Secondly, you see how, example, Top Boy. Mm-hmm. Top Boy has been out for a while. It's been out for a while.
Mm.
But before, it was only UK people that were like paying watching attention it. Because our thing. But because we stuck to it, like, this is our thing. And we supported it. And we literally begged them for another episode. And when they did the other episode and Drake saw it, everyone, you know, and it popped off on Netflix, now everybody's jumping on it. And it's always been British to the core. And my American friend was asking me, is that how England really is? I was like, bro, every bit you saw in that thing is authentic in England.
Yeah.
And I told him, go watch this film, Adulthood.
Mm-hmm.
That came out a while back. Mm-hmm. Adulthood. It's a shame that it's not very pop. It's not popular now.
Yeah.
But if it came out now, it will blow people away. If you haven't watched it, watch Adulthood. They were young kids.
Yeah.
But the shit that they were doing in that film, I was saying to my friends in Ghana, this is authentically English. Like, there's nothing copying about it. This is England.
What they do, yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I saw a group of guys in Germany, bless their hearts. I know some of them. I hope they're watching this, but forgive me. They're doing this YouTube series, and it kind of looks like Top Boy.
Okay.
They're kind of going for the gangs. And I'm like, this isn't German. Germany don't have that too tough. You can't fake certain things.
Yeah. Yeah.
Be original. That's what I'm trying to say. Just be original. Keep your authentic.
But what's original though?
What's
like, because me now, I'm thinking, what's originally German?
I feel like original is channeling where you're from, what your surroundings are like, what you and your friends are like, talking about your authentic experiences. For example, if you go back to grime music, at that time they used to have ciphers, like they'll be in a little small room and it'll be about 20 boys, everybody battling, and sometimes we'll break into fights. Do you know what I mean? Because these were like what we call roadmen, you know, roadmen.
Yeah.
So it's kind of like that was their authentic experience at that time.
Mm-hmm.
Same as hip hop in America when it first started.
Yeah.
They were being authentic. They were saying things that was going on around them in New York. Do you know what I mean? A New Yorker wouldn't rap about an experience in Texas that he didn't know about. Do you know what I mean? And that's also the reason why when the South started doing hip hop, at first it was just big in the South because they were authentic to themselves and they were the only people who knew the experiences that, you know, was going on in the South. So the people in the East Coast and the West Coast probably wasn't rocking with it. But as long as you keep being your authentic self and keep it moving, people will gravitate and they see the originality and the authenticity in what you're doing. And that's what people like. People actually see, like, you're being real. Realness always wins.
Mm. Even in the music scene, everything that's blowing up are people who are speaking the language. Who are speaking German. Unfortunately, we don't have too many black people who are actually doing music in our language, in German. Mm. And for me personally, it was always a thing that was on my heart, to be fair, because I've been working with the likes of Frenna, for instance, who is one of the biggest artists in the Netherlands.
Mm.
He does his music in Dutch. Just recently, I've been working with two artists, one called, I will misquote it, but they just released music from France. Mm. It's French. The black people are speaking French there. Mm. So I feel like if we stick to the language as well, we would actually appeal to our people, but we don't.
I think the challenge in that is, as black people, the bigger market for black people, it's outside of Germany.
Yeah.
And most of the black people outside of Germany don't speak German.
Yeah, that's true.
So it's kind of like, you want to reach outside Germany, what do you do?
But then if you try to reach outside Germany, that's where you... I don't think your focus should be outside Germany then.
You don't think so?
I don't think so. I feel like you should be original to yourself. Mm-hmm. And me as a German right now, and us having this conversation, I feel like we should have done music in German. And we should have done it for ourselves. Mm. Because in doing that, we would actually have the identity that is missing.
Mm.
The originality that is missing. I feel like we are not original.
You're right. I've never actually thought about that. I think... I don't think it... Not necessarily rap music. Because I don't speak German. It's hard for me to relate to German music. But I think singing... And R&B music translates better in different languages than rap does. Because I listen to South African music,
mm-hmm.
and they are singing in their language. I don't understand a word they're saying, but I love the music.
Yeah.
I don't know if I can listen to South African rap.
Mm.
Do you know what I mean? So I think singing
makes it works, softer.
It makes it softer. It lands better.
I hear it.
But even that, nobody's doing it.
No one.
And I think you're right. That would have probably given you guys more of an identity and a collectiveness.
Yeah, or like... You're saying R&B. I'm saying maybe something like Afrobeats.
Afrobeats.
Mm. Afrobeats is all about the beat. It's all about how you feel, the vibe that you get. Make it in German. Mm. Like, but as I said, make it soft. Make it people. You know what? There's this friend of mine. She's been introducing me to a lot of music. And also like music from back then. And she's been showing me some German music as well. There's one song, because I understand the language and the lingo so well, I can actually identify myself with that song, where even though it's a white person who did that song.
Mm.
So how much more a black person who's speaking the experience of Germany in his own native language is German, and he's the same color as me.
Mm-hmm.
I would connect even more.
Mm.
Because I'm thinking, there's this one song that she showed me. It's just talking about how he wants to take his girl to a trip. And even though he doesn't have money and stuff, he will just take the girl to a trip. And with me, there was some times where money was low. So, but you still want to do stuff. Mm. But, so when I actually resonated with that song so well that I actually put, it's one of my favorite songs.
Mm.
Imagine a black person talking about how he grew up, how it was difficult or... the challenges he faced, or how he's just with his people and they do a vibe and out or something. I feel like it would hit home
way more. Yeah, I'm going to show my age now. There's a German lady who made a song years ago. She made it in German called, my German is terrible, it's called Neune Neute
Luftballons.
I know that song from my childhood. And do you know that she made an English version of that song?
Yeah.
It didn't go
anywhere. It didn't bang.
The German version plays till today. The English version didn't. I have it on my playlist.
No way.
Because it reminds me of my childhood.
Crazy.
And I didn't even know what language is at that time. I only realized it was German about maybe say 7 years ago.
Nah.
Yeah. And the English version didn't bang, like the German version. Why? Because people gravitated towards the originality.
Originality.
When she did the English version, I was like, what's the point? Waste of studio time. Like, So, yeah, I think black Germans are missing out when it comes to that collectiveness. And I think music can do it for them. I don't know how that's going to kind of work out now. Because I feel like it's getting a bit too late for that now. But I don't know.
I'm being honest with you, I can't be bothered.
Oh, why not?
I can't be bothered. Because at the end of the day, people would say that I might be in a good position to do so.
Mm.
But I have things going on right now where I feel like I need to... It takes everything of me to... make those things happen, right? So there's nothing left of me to focus on rebuilding the culture or doing stuff in Germany where it is a hit and miss.
Mm.
Because we are talking about grime, right? Mm. And you said it's when, 19, where?
Maybe 2002.
So grime started in 2002.
But
so I feel like for something like that to cultivate, it takes time.
Mm.
It would take another, like, maybe it took, like, you said grime came up, and then when Dizzy Rascal came up,
mm-hmm.
that's where it blew up, right?
It kind of started getting
okay, so popular, yeah. So do you have like a, do you know how long it took for Dizzy Rascal to come on the scene to make it?
He was on the scene since grime started, around when grime started, but I think his first album, Boy in the Corner, I don't know the date, but maybe about, took about 3-4 years.
3-4 years.
Yeah, so, I might be wrong, but
yeah. It just goes to show that it will take a certain amount of time for it to blow.
Mm.
Especially if you now have to win the hearts of your community and for them to ride with you and all them kind of stuff. Mm. It will take some time. And with Germany, it will take you even longer than it will take UK.
Mm.
So I can't be bothered.
Yeah.
It will be a good thing though.
Again, that is you being a part of the problem.
That's me being a part of the problem. Yeah. Maybe I'm being too selfish here as well.
Well, I mean, one man can't save the whole community.
I hear it.
But I think maybe you might be the person to spark someone's mind to kind of...
I feel like this conversation has already sparked my mind, to be fair.
Bro, it's like when I moved to Hamburg and people say to me, why are you in Hamburg? Like, there's nothing here. I'm like, I know there's nothing here.
Mm.
But that's the problem. There's nothing here. You sit in it. Why don't you do something?
Mm.
Do you know what I mean? Don't just say there's nothing here and just sit in it.
Mm.
So for me, this podcast is my way of kind of waking... Black doing Germans something. Up. Yeah. Like, yo, you guys are... There's a lot of opportunities here and you guys are fucking up, honestly.
Mm.
Honestly. What pisses me off is... And it shouldn't piss me off because British people are my man them.
Yeah.
But because I'm here now, yeah. I have this affinity with Germany. Guys from England will come to Germany during the summertime and then have these old school parties and raves and everything. And German people will go buy tickets, have fun, and they'll... post Instagram, just think is the best thing ever. And they'll be waiting for next year's version. And then these boys come here, throw the rave, and they take your money and they take it back to England. True. And you, the Germans, are sitting here watching this happen. Do you think English black people will sit there for a German person to come there, throw a black rave, take that money, and then leave to come back to Germany, and they'll be sitting there watching?
No way.
You must be out of your mind. Why are we allowing... Why are you allowing this? Like, I don't care because they're English boys. Get your money. But if you're as a black German, you've been to one of these events and you've seen it work and you've seen how much money that these people are making and how popular it is, and you don't think to yourself, hold on, I need to do this. Why am I waiting for somebody from England to come and do this? And you don't see that, bro, you have a problem. So you can't tell me the opportunities are not there. It's there. People are just not doing it. You're not.
Yeah.
They're fucking up. Yeah, so this is my point for having this podcast. Like, I need black Germans to wake up and understand you have, especially black Germans. Because in the UK, God's grace, we get opportunities in terms of like work and careers and that. We actually get good employment.
Yeah.
It's not that popular here.
No.
So you guys are supposed to do your own thing from underground, have your own businesses, do your own sort of like, if whether it's a rave. I went to university with this guy. He uses student loan to set up raves. He didn't pay attention in the class. He just started doing raves with a student loan when he first started. By the time we finished university, this boy had so much money and we had nothing. Do you know what I mean? So even that ingenuity, like, do you know what I'm saying? It starts from just seeing things and just being smart. So I don't know why people here don't really...
You know one thing, yeah? I feel like, not to defend my fellow Germans, but I feel like...
Oh, you have to defend them.
It's difficult to start things here.
Oh.
It's very difficult. I remember there was this one time where I was working as a delivery driver.
Mm.
So basically what we were doing, we would get medications and stuff and we would deliver to the pharmacies and stuff like that. So at one point I was like, bro, this job is easy, like... Get a car, get someone to drive it, and then he would just be delivering whatever medicine to the pharmacies, and then you get money for each trip, or like, there's like, this car is making you money, right? So I thought to me, let me start it. Let me just start open. Let me open a company. Like the amount of difficulties I faced.
Difficulties from?
From the government.
And paperwork. And stuff.
Paperwork. All of that. If you're not someone who's who can persevere through stuff like that, it would just put you off. And I feel like that's something that this city of Hamburg doesn't give you. So it never crossed my mind to establish a business in London and to be working for myself. Mm. It never crossed my mind. Mm. I always wanted to be employed or do something. It never crossed my mind. However, if you try something like that here, the difficulty that it brings puts people off.
Do you think there's an element of fear?
100%.
Because what I see is, I see a lot of people breaking the rules. In a lot of Germany, when you go to shops, they only take cash.
Yeah.
Why do they do that? Because they don't want to pay certain taxes you know, card payments. That's breaking the rules.
Mm.
They're not afraid. And I think there's an idea here, and I don't know how long, I haven't tested it, but there's an idea here that, and I know it's very difficult to open a business and the paperwork and everything, but why can't you just do it without the paperwork? You're afraid of getting caught?
Maybe. But you see, like, the consequences when you get caught, they're immense.
What's the consequences?
Bro.
Maybe I need to know this.
Bro, the consequences, like, for instance, my mom was telling me about, I don't know. Like, my mom was telling me about someone who was like very, very big in Hamburg, and obviously some paperwork didn't go through well. Or he didn't do some whatever whatnot. Mm. Or, you know, that person didn't play by the book.
Mm.
It took the Germans maybe like two years to maybe demolish everything he had built.
Mm.
In what, 10 years or 20 years, right? And that person was like one of the biggest person like here in the city. So maybe it's that. Maybe it's fear that the feds will like get onto you and like destroy everything and put some massive shame on you, like, because it will be a public.
Yeah, I don't think they encourage entrepreneurship in
general. No, they don't. Mm. I don't feel like they don't.
Mm.
Especially for us. For us black people, I feel like it's even way more difficult.
Mm.
Some people are doing it.
Mm.
But I feel like a lot of people that are doing great stuff here, there's a bit of thingy in there.
Mm.
Or they're actually from somewhere else where they have like their mindset has been reshaped or recalibrated to a certain degree where they don't think like typical Germans.
Mm. Yeah.
And I feel like that's the key in order to for you to
move forward, to get out the German mindset.
You have to.
Because, for example, I mean, I get what you're saying in terms of it might be hard to start businesses, but I don't think, it doesn't necessarily have to be a business as an, you know, an e-commerce business or a service business. I mean, for example, like the rave, the parties thing I'm talking about, how much paperwork do you need to throw a party?
True.
Find a venue. Speak to the venue. This is how much I'm going to, this is how many people I know. If you have a database of a lot of people, I can bring maybe 200-300 people to your bar every Saturday. I'll take the money at the door. Mm. You take the money from the drinks. Bro, how much paperwork do you need for that?
That's true.
You don't have to wait from some. The people coming from the UK to come and throw these old school parties, you think they have paperwork. Yeah, they don't got no paperwork. They just come take your money and they just go. So it's just fear. I think there's a genuine fear. The fear is from a good place, but I think there's certain ways around, and you have to be fearless when it comes to these kind of things. I'm not saying anybody should go do no crime I'm just sharing ideas. Let me just put that out there.
Yeah.
But yeah, so if we go back to more of your life, so when you went to London and you saw all these things, and you went to the to university, you studied music
and film
in university.
Mm.
When did it click for you?
When I had my first hit. to be fair, I was just doing things. So there was never really like a plan.
Yeah.
I was just doing things. Just so how it got to the how it got to my first hit was like I got to know Steven Boy Darius. So I got to know Steven, he knew I play saxophone, whatever, whatnot. And then he was like, bro, like I got track here, track there. And then they would do music, they'll produce music and then want me to play sax on it. So I'll play sax on one or two tracks and I remember. And then the track that opened everything was one track. I, at that time I was living in South London, drove all the way to North London with £20 in my pocket. Like I didn't have any money anymore. So went there just to record, recorded a track with them. And then that track got mixed because at that time, composers were working with Jay Haas a lot. It's the era where he did Common Sense. Yeah. So that track got mixed by J5, who was the producer, or who is the producer, right?
Yeah.
And he heard the saxophones. Like, he was like, oh, right.
Who's that?
Who's that?
Yeah.
I need this guy.
Yeah. Look, them breaks are amazing when they happen, man.
Bro, who's that saxophone? Yeah. This sound is nuts. Mm. Like, so apparently he already wanted me for options. And then options, that track. But then they messed up my number or something, so I didn't get that track. But then when the other track came, which is Dave Burner Boy Location, he was like, no, I need this guy now.
But you're on Location.
And so I'm on Location.
Jesus.
So that's how everything happened. So when I got, I didn't even know.
I need to go listen to Locations now.
I didn't even know, bro. I just went there. I was like, oh, yeah, bro, you're right. Yeah, my name is J5. I have Dave's song with Burner Boy. Would you play some sax on there? It's like, yeah, sure. Why not? Went to the studio. It wasn't Ealing at that time. Went to the studio, played some lines on there, played some sax on there. Bro, the next thing I know, it is one of the biggest tracks in UK history.
Yeah.
In that year specifically, bro, it went like all of a sudden I hear I'm platinum. All of a sudden I'm gold. I have the number one in the UK. Yeah. I'm like, what?
Yeah.
So that's where now focus came in, direction came in. Now I knew, okay, this is what I want to do. I want to get more of this. I want to. So, and that's what UK does with you, I feel like. It will shift your mind to a certain degree. And if you if you're consistent with what you do, like at one point it will just blow off.
Blow off, yeah.
And then you're
all
off.
You need is that one.
One.
Yeah, no, that's a very good story, man.
Yeah, but that's a very good story. Don't have that here in Germany, though.
Yeah. I'll give you, since you mentioned the composers, I'll give you another thing that shows that another story that shows the disparity amongst Black Germans and Black British people. The composers. I heard of the composers a very long time ago.
Yeah.
They used to play in a church.
Yeah.
And I heard of a band in Germany that used to play in a church. And me and my wife, when we were about to get married, we were deciding, if we get married in, because I always wanted a live band for my wedding.
Okay.
Like, if we get married in London, I would love for the composers to be the live band. They weren't that big then, so probably I could have afforded it.
Yeah.
If we get married in Germany, we can use this band in Germany. So we got married in Germany. So we use this band in Germany. I'm not going to mention their name, but they know themselves.
I was about to ask who.
They started around the same time as the composers.
Okay.
Right now, I don't think they're playing music anymore. They've just disbanded. I met what they came to our wedding with a young lady who actually sang. She came here randomly like a couple of months ago. Mm. And I asked her what happened to the band. She's like, they're not really playing anymore. Look at them and look at the composers. They started at the same time. Both as good as each other. The composers are not any more better than they are.
Mm.
But the composers are like flying and they haven't really, you know, got off to, you know, it hasn't really taken off for them. So I ask myself, what's the reason? Is it the fact that they didn't have the opportunities or did they just not see themselves in that position?
Okay, so I had the privilege to be working with them for a very long time now. These boys, they see themselves as superstars. Like, like when they so I have a when ever since I've been working with them, it's something that I've put in my mind, bro. Like, you can be as big as you are. We are as big as we are in our, bro. Like, you can't belittle our thing here. And I feel like the boys have been consistent, because now if you check, it's a 10th year where they've been a band playing for other people and stuff like that. 10 years of the composers. Mm. So it is hard work. It is not backing down. It is taking L's but getting up again. It is all of that. And if you have the right mentality, you shoot out. Like, and I feel like sometimes also patience is virtue. Mm. Like, sometimes we think like it just has to like blow right there and then. Mm. But I don't feel like that's the key to success. I feel like it is gradually, step by step, and you can see it now. The boys are maybe one of the best paid musicians that are around.
They're amazing.
They're just sold out like a Royal Albert Hall, which is like one of the prestigious halls in London. Like a band.
Yeah.
Not to belittle them, but a band like does that. So we are looking at like Coldplay and all that kind of stuff. Yeah. They did stuff like that too.
Royal Albert Hall was big.
It's a big thing.
Yeah, everybody when even Jay-Z went to Royal Albert Hall, he was like, yeah,
it's a big venue. Yeah. Next year they're doing Wembley. Like,
they're predominantly Ghanaian too, aren't they?
All of them are Ghanaians.
This band I'm talking about, Germany, all of them are Ghanaians. So there's not much, but I don't know the reason as to why, comparing the two of them, as to why one has gone to that level and the other one has kind of fizzled out.
Maybe it just goes back to the fact that they didn't position themselves well. Mm. Also, you see how we said like there's no originality in ourselves. So probably the industry didn't recognize them as something that could be pushed or something that could be used. Mm. I don't know. I just know that the boys are hardworking.
Yeah, yeah.
I know that the boys are hardworking, and every one of them has that mindset of like, all right, cool, we're in this together. We are four black boys who come from ends and who are just making this music thing, right? So it is the story.
Yeah, they're amazing. Yeah. They are amazing. Ever since the first time I heard them, and I was straight away, because I really like live music. Mm. So when I heard them first, I was like, nah, these guys are incredible.
Yeah.
So obviously we've spoken a lot about the difference that London has made for you.
Mm.
And we've touched on sort of like how we see kind of like London being more inspiring, and how maybe there's a little bit more work to be done in Germany for these things. So moving forward, do you see in any way at all a way in which black Germans can kind of tie in these loose ends? And maybe it might be from the music side or maybe from another side. Is there a way, because you've been here longer than I have.
Yeah.
So is there a way that, no matter how outlandish it sounds, is there a way that you feel like black Germans can kind of like come together in any small sort of?
I feel like one of the things that everywhere, like if you check history even, that brings us black people together is art. So I believe that if we could use that that avenue of art for our advantage here in Germany, I believe that we could actually build something. However, one thing I struggle to see is that there's not too much of unity amongst us. So I believe if there could be a common goal, a common mindset, if there could be brotherly love, where we don't look at you anyhow, but we support actually what you're doing, and we actually rate your thing, the way in UK, people rate their things. Like, I rate your thing, you rate my thing. Mm. So, unless we're ops, but then, you know, if we can come to a place where we actually rate each other and we rate the things that we are doing and other people are doing, I believe that we could actually build something here and establish something for us that would give us the originality and that would give us that identity that we are looking for.
I agree. I mean, let's not glamorize it because it took a long time and some hard work in the UK to get to that point. So it's definitely not going to be easy by a long shot. But I think in the very least, conversations like this should be starting to be had. I think people need to start speaking more about what the core problems are. I see a lot of, and it's always important to discuss racism. Always important to bring light to racism. I see a lot of that going on, which is fine. But I think that until Black Germans can look at each other and say, you know what, we have a part to play in making our situation better. And actively doing that, I think they need to do it for themselves without looking outside. That's also a journey that I think Black Germans need to take. I don't know where they are with that.
Me personally, I know that whenever I come here, I feel racism. I feel racism. It's very, very evident. However, not even however, but it can get you to a place where you just lay back and you just push the blame to like the system is racist, so I can't be the best of myself. But I feel like what happened in or what's happening in UK is that in as much as there's racism in UK,
quiet racism,
they don't care. I'll still do my thing, like no matter what you think, and I won't blame you for it. Like, I'll take it upon myself and become great. And I feel like if we as Black Germans can get to that place where we don't blame the systems, we don't blame, but we are, in spite of how the system is, we will still strive. If we get to that place, I feel like that's a very good start. Because sometimes, even me, as I said, like, it is easier to be like, because the system is not helping us, let me just dip to UK. That's what I did, to be honest. Because the system is not helping. But if we have some people who can be like, because the system is not helping, that's why I'm gonna make it. I feel like that would be a very good starting point. And as you said, having conversations, talking about it, thinking, like, let's reason together. Let's like think about, let's just join hands.
Let's join people hands. Power.
Let's be together. I remember me and my guy, his name is Lordy. He does like an Afrofusion restaurant kind of thing. And 2 years ago we were both brokenhearted, and then we decided to make something. So you bring your food thing. He's like a food artist. That's how he calls himself. He's a food artist. I'm a musician. You provide the food, I provide the music. We did it for 1 month. The money that we make, immense. So let's join hands. You bring your talent, I bring my talent. Let's do something together.
That's amazing.
Yeah,
that's amazing. I think you're absolutely right. I think the aside from the unity in terms of supporting, there's also supposed to be, I think, unity in terms of working together.
Yeah.
In a genuine way.
In a genuine way.
In a genuine way. Not just because, like in a genuine way.
I actually want to work with you and actually want to see you. Like, I feel like our heart sometimes is a bit some style. So it's a bit some way. Like, we don't want to see each other do well.
Yeah. It was like that in London for a while. But it became undeniable that somebody's doing well. And no matter how much you're hating, that person's doing well. So you have to look at yourself.
Okay.
Do you know what I mean? And I think it can happen here. When people are doing so well, you stop hating, but then you look at yourself and be like, what am I doing?
Yeah, I need to step up my game.
Step up my game. And that's when I think people start. But collectively, I think, yeah, black Germans need to work together in a genuine way. Yeah. I agree with you.
Because there's so much gifts and talents amongst
Absolutely.
Us. Absolutely. Like, we're so blessed as a people. So. Absolutely.
Yeah, at the end of the day, you're black people. And our black people, we're the culture. We make the culture.
Like,
culture doesn't move until we move. And yeah. I don't think black Germans have noticed that yet. They need to make sure that they're moving the culture. In
you just open them. Like, I feel like now I need to do something. I don't know.
Bro, if you decide to do something, I like me. No, I'm here. This is what I'm about. So I just want to have conversations and explore these topics. Bro, I appreciate you, man.
Thank you so much for having me.
Thanks for coming, man.
Thank you so much for having me, man.
Appreciate you. Let the people know what you have coming on next after this tour. Do you know what you're doing next?
So I'm touring the whole of December, and then I'll have,
30 December.
Yeah, crazy. tour the whole of December. I'll have do the O2 in London.
When is that?
That's 28th of January, if I'm not mistaken.
I won't be back from Ghana. I'd have come to see you.
Yeah, doing London, doing Paris, and then doing Madison Square Garden.
Shit.
Yeah, bro, that's a big one still. Doing Madison Square Garden somewhere in April. And then I'm going to do... I have something lined up. I can't open up yet. Mm-hmm. But, some little business ventures that I'm trying to establish. So,
yeah, and this is in London?
That's global, bro.
Global.
I want to go global that's still. Like, just have a look out.
Yeah.
And God willing, if God blesses everything, it will be amazing and great.
No doubt, no doubt.
Yeah.
Nah, love, bro.
Come on, man. I appreciate you too, bro. Thank you for having me, man.
Nah, no doubt.
It was amazing.
This is what it's about. This is what it's about. We need to have more of these conversations.
100%.